rejoice and ever rejoice in his consolation. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Oh, I left it in another bag.
That's all right, I've got another copy. So you can have a copy in both bodies.
Oh, good. Thank you very much.
Well, I want to tell you first, I think I've told you that I've never been through the Bible in this way before, with this kind of focus. I'm having more fun. Learning stuff that...
Well, I'm glad somebody is.
Learning stuff I should have known years ago. But, okay, let's see. Who shall I pick on today? No, I have a volunteer. Okay, Mary. We're starting in the book of Luke. Now, notice, remember, that the beginning material is some of the most complex material in the whole of the gospel. So, again, we're going to take it slowly and go through a part of this, not all of this, because you'll notice in Luke, you have a very long introduction. Because Luke chapter 1 alone is 80 verses. And then you see that introduction continues into chapter 2. And so we won't look at all of that because I want to get to John. And then I want to start dealing with other covenants as they work throughout the New Testament. So Mary, would you begin reading chapter 1, verse 1? And as usual, I will interrupt you, is it okay?
Since many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the events that have been fulfilled among us.
Okay, notice. What do you notice immediately?
He's referring to others.
That's right. That's one thing. So notice, other people have done this too. That's one of the reasons. People say, well, Matthew, Mark, and John are probably the same way because he refers to that. Okay, what else do you notice in what you just read?
He talks about events that were fulfilled.
Ah, exactly. Events that fulfill. That, remember, fulfill. Complete. And remember earlier we looked at a passage in Matthew about, well, in fact it was, out of Egypt I have called my son. And we looked back into Hosea. Do you remember what I'm talking about? Tell you what, let's go to Matthew, right? I'll come back to Luke.
Archelaus was ruling over Judea in place of his father Herod. He was afraid to go back there. And because he had been warned in a dream, he departed for the region of Galilee. He went and dwelt in a town called Nazareth, so that what has been spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled. He shall be called a Nazarene.
Okay, one of the things that you find in Matthew again and again and again as he began, remember? Fulfilled, fulfilled, fulfilled. Now I want you to go back to what the previous passage, chapter 2, verse 13.
When they had departed, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Rise, take the child and his mother, flee to Egypt and stay there until I tell you. Herod is going to search for the child to destroy him." Joseph rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed for Egypt. He stayed there until the death of Herod, that what the Lord had said through the prophet might be fulfilled. Out of Egypt I called my son.
Okay. Now, this is, but notice, fulfill, fulfill, fulfill. You get this over and over again. And I could keep pointing out things. All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken to the Lord through the prophet. Look, a virgin shall conceive. Do you see what I mean? Constant. Okay. Now, it says that Joseph took Jesus and Mary into Egypt was to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, right? Okay, let's go to the prophet. That's Hosea chapter 11. And Hosea begins that group of short prophets. Is that right after Daniel? Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea. It's way over toward the New Testament.
Which chapter?
Way over toward the New Testament.
Which chapter is Hosea?
Chapter 11. You've got what I needed. Some of the earlier translations had the more I so you see why I, okay, now, do you see anything predicted here?
Egypt. Out of Egypt, I call my son.
But that's past, isn't it? That's not something to come, that's not future, agreed? Out of Egypt, I called past tense.
But verse 5 says, he shall return to the land of Egypt.
That's right. But the quotation in Matthew is, when Israel was a child, I loved him. Out of Egypt, I called my son, right?
Yeah.
So there's no prediction right there, is there? Out of Egypt, I called my son, refers to something in the past, correct? Mm-hmm. Now, would you turn with me to Exodus, chapter Genesis, the second book of the Bible, Exodus 4. Exodus 4. Exodus 4. And 22, verse 22. Now this is when God is talking to Moses, telling him what to say to Pharaoh. The people are in Egypt. Okay, start with verse 22, Jim.
So you shall say to Pharaoh, thus says the Lord, Israel is my son, my firstborn. Hence I tell you, let my son go, that he may serve me. If you refuse to let him go, I warn you, I will kill your son, your firstborn.
Okay, notice. And right in the beginning, while they're in Egypt, right? God says, Israel, who is Israel here? The people. Israel is my firstborn son, right? Okay. So notice, let's go back now to Hosea. I should have told you to call that place. I'm sorry. 11, chapter 11.
The more I called them, the farther they went from me.
Ah, what happened while they were in the desert?
They
rebelled. Again. What did they do to when they got just got out of Egypt? Remember the golden calf? So you see what this is referring to. Keep reading, Jim.
Sacrificing to the Baals and burning incense to idols.
After they got into the land, they began to worship Baal. I mean, see, this Hosea was written in the 8th century, not too long before they were taken into captivity. And see, the Exodus occurred around 13, probably, whoops, not time, B.C., probably around 1250, say. And see, he's referring to way back there. Okay, keep reading.
Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk.
Who is Ephraim?
His person.
Son of Joseph.
The son of Joseph, and how does he get connected here?
And Reuben lost his firstborn status, and he chose Ephraim.
Ephraim becomes the people. That's right. Reuben slept with his father's concubine, or secondary wife. And because he did that, that was regarded as disinheriting himself. No surprise, surely. And so then Jacob adopts Joseph's second son as his firstborn. Remember I told you, firstborn only doesn't necessarily indicate biology. It's the one who will follow in his father's tradition. Well, let me remind you, does Abraham have an older son? Oldest? Who?
Ishmael.
Isaac was his second son.
Ishmael
wasn't yet in Genesis. Take your son, your only son, Isaac. Well, Isaac wasn't his only son. He had an older son. All right.
That gets so confusing.
That's, yes. Because this is so foreign to us.
Yeah.
You know, that's one of the reasons writers will say we are very literal people. I'll give you an example of one of the things I'm referring to. When I was talking to my students about attitudes in the 14th century. Now what? Way, 14th century? AD. That's a long way from what we're talking about here, right? I said, okay, when they talked about, you know, what the influence is on you, they would talk about it in much different ways. We talk about genetics and environment, right? And I said, you know, people in those days thought in terms of what does a person think as expressed in his words and actions. I said, but okay, Mark Twain, roughly contemporary, 20th century exactly, Mark Twain became an embittered old man. I don't know, I think, you know, he wrote some wonderful works, but the older he got, the more bitter he became, and that's not too great stuff. I said, okay, from our perspective, we'd say, all right, Mark Twain's parents died when he was young. Make sure your parents don't die when you're young, okay? And if they do die, don't go live with your spinster aunt, he did, okay? And make sure you stay in school, because he quit school, he became a sea captain, he went, well, you know, okay, if it's environment and heredity, you know, we can't do anything about that, okay? But notice, these people thought in terms of, okay, he was an embittered old man. What was it that was in his head that caused him to become bitter? He blamed God for the death of his children and his wife. He was devolving. Okay,
Did that have anything to do with his heredity?
Good to see you.
Did it have anything directly to do with his environment? His wife was a very devout woman. You would think she would have been able to... But notice, is what does a person think as expressed in words and actions? I don't want to think the way he thought, because I don't want to become a bitter old man. This is, okay, so a firstborn son or an older son has to do with, okay, is he in his father's tradition, not biology, but is he thinking the way his father thinks? Let me give you a New Testament example. The Pharisees said, Abraham is our father, to Jesus. Do you remember what Jesus said? I can raise up children of Abraham from these very stones. Remember that? So notice, it's not biology that the Bible is concerned with as much as following a tradition. We still have something like this when we said, oh, she's just like her mother. And are we talking about bloodline? See what I mean?
Not necessarily.
Not necessarily. So we still have something of this. So notice, Ephraim becomes a substitute name for Israel. Verse 4. But do you see now, let's go back to Matthew. Rosie, put the Bible in here. I think.
Joseph rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed for Egypt. He stayed there until the death of Herod, that what the Lord had said through the prophet might be fulfilled. Out of Egypt I called my son.
Okay, and notice there's no future tense anywhere in this. So, fulfill means to complete, not prediction, and it happened. That's a major difference between us Catholics and evangelicals, fundamentalists, they're sometimes called. They say, well, God predicted it and it happened. That's not the Catholic understanding. God promised and fulfilled his promise. Do you see the difference? Okay, if there's any, is there any prediction there?
You mean the fundamentalists?
No, I'm talking about in Matthew. Was anything predicted in Isaiah and Hosea? Notice reference to something earlier. So, let my son go, I will heal your firstborn. Israel is my firstborn son. Okay, now you can say that was a prediction that was fulfilled. But it was also a promise, a warning. And I heard one teacher put it like this. Didn't some of you say, if you don't stop that, you're going to be in big trouble?
Oh, no, we
didn't. Okay, that's the same thing. Let my son go, I will kill your firstborn. Yeah, that's the warning. You can say, well, it's a prediction, but it's really a warning. Okay, Pharaoh didn't let him go. Let them go. And then Hosea is referring to that time in the past. And then Matthew is also referring to that time in the past, and he's calling it fulfillment. A promise fulfilled. Okay, let's go back to Luke now. We're looking at the gospel according to Luke, but because of something that, something that Mary read, and I'm going to start again from the beginning, Mary. We're in Luke chapter 1.
Since many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the events that have been fulfilled among us.
Ah, okay. You see? The events that have been fulfilled. Go ahead.
Just as those who were eyewitnesses from the beginning and ministers of the word have handed them down to us.
And by the way, one of the first things the apostles did after the ascension was to gather a group together. But even before the Holy Spirit, before Pentecost, what did, I've forgotten whether it's before or after Pentecost, but they chose another apostle. You remember this? Okay. So, you see the kinds of things he's referring to, eyewitness. And one of the qualifications for this new apostle would be that he had been an eyewitness. Go ahead, please, Mary.
I too have decided, after investigating everything accurately anew, to write it down in an orderly sequence for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may realize the certainty of the teachings you have received.
Okay, now, so he's writing an orderly account, and by the way, that's one of the things that is unique about our four Gospels. And when I say unique, I mean different from any of the host of other Gospels. There are Gospels running up your ears. There are so many of them. Gospel of Thomas, Gospel of Mary, Gospel of Judas, Gospel of Nicodemus. But going on, this one of the big differences, one of them, is that all four of our Gospels are an orderly account. And I remember talking about the Gospels one day to a group of teachers. By the way, this teacher is no longer teaching in the Catholic school. But I was asked to talk to the teachers about the Gospels, generally. And one of the teachers said, this is ridiculous. Don't tell me way back then they could have written in such a complicated way. As I say, she's no longer teaching in the Catholic school, and I'm grateful. if you think this is primitive stuff, then primitive means very complicated and very heady, as well as very spiritual. Okay, Mary. Theophilus. What does the word Theophilus mean? Do you know?
Lover of God.
Lover of God. Okay. Is Luke writing to lovers of God? Or is he writing to a person? Scholars disagree. Big deal. I don't see that it makes that much difference. Question or comment to you? Okay, keep reading, Mary.
I just had one question. Yes. So, do we know for sure that he wrote the Gospel before he wrote the Acts?
Actually, they seem to be a two-volume work. In other words, Acts is actually just a continuation of Luke. And one of the neat things about it is that since Luke is writing in the book of Acts about things that happened in the early church, the language ties those together very well because they were both written by the same person.
But that would have been written more like a reporting style, right? Because he is living through the Acts, where this would be more of a, you know, compiling what other people are telling him.
Again, a discussion by scholars. How much of this did Luke experience? Part of it for sure, because he switches at one point from they to we. And so, again, he collected material, but for part of it at least, he was an actor too. In other words, he was in it, and so it was an eyewitness account, that part. Am I responding?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, good. Any other question or comment here? Okay, Mary, go ahead.
In the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah.
Remember we went through earlier and looked at the Hasmonean family and then the Idumean or Edomite who became a convert to Judaism, Herod. But what a horrible, horrible family that was. Well, even before Herod, they were killing each other, even killing their own children, because their children weren't following in their tradition. And so you got, and they were married umpteen times. And you remember that one of the reasons John the Baptist was killed was that he told Herod he shouldn't be married to his brother's wife. So you got all this kind of stuff. But this is King Herod. He's called the Great because he was the great builder. Ah, the Western Wall that we hear about in Israel, that was part of the foundation of the great temple that Herod built for the Jews. But he built a number of cities calling them Herodias, or Herodium. So he spread his wealth around. Okay, go ahead. Start again. 5.
In the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the priestly division of Abijah.
Okay, again, we looked somewhat briefly at what David did, and this material is in Chronicles. Let me see, I think I wrote that down. Yes. This material, for your reference, would be 1 Chronicles 23. David organized all, the Levites. Some were to be priests. What are some of the other duties of the Levites? You remember?
They were the priests.
The Levites were the priests, but remember all the Sadducees or
catechized, we're not priests.
Right.
Okay.
They also judges.
They were judges in the sense of settling squabbles. Okay, what else?
Were they scribes?
They were scribes. What else? Musicians, gatekeepers, every builders, carpenters. They were everything, but everything they did had to do with what? God and the service of God for the people. Remember, the Levite, the descendants of Levi, did not have an inheritance. Rather, what happened to them?
The people had to care for them.
The people were to care for them because they were in every single one of the tribal territories. Even though there was one temple, there were all sorts of things that had to do with ministry. And so the Levites were scattered among all the tribes. Okay, so now, David did all this organizing. But did all of David's sons follow in his tradition? No way. The priest just before King Hezekiah, he closed the temple, took the vessels out of it, brought them up to be used for other purposes. Now this is a king of Judah. And he worshiped the Baals. He worshiped the god of the Aram. I'll get it out in a minute. Gods of Aram, which would be modern-day Syria. And it was all over. His son Hezekiah, and this is in 2 Chronicles chapter 31, is king, the good King Hezekiah repaired the temple, had it purified, and divided, had the Levites all come, and he reappointed everybody to the position. So this is the result of what Hezekiah had done. Zechariah is follower of the priesthood order of Abijah. That's the ancestor. Abijah is one of the sons of Aaron. And, oh, it tells you, I'm sorry. Okay, starting at verse 5.
In the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the priestly division of Abijah. His wife was from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. Both were righteous in the eyes of God, observing all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord blamelessly.
Okay, now, they were righteous and blameless. Do you remember anybody in the Old Testament material who was righteous and blameless?
Abraham.
Yep. Who else?
Noah.
Yes.
Daniel.
Okay, you got it. Notice he's in the tradition of the great ones of old. You following? Okay. Continue, please.
But they had no child because Elizabeth was barren and both were advanced in years.
Okay, do you remember any old man, and an old woman?
Abraham.
And get hung up in years, they had a child. Okay? By the way, don't you see what Luke is reminding people of? Remember, they had no New Testament.
The New Testament is being written. So what has the church been reading when they met together on the Lord's Day?
Old Testament.
So, and remember, the Jews memorized it. So I just said blameless, click, click, click. Don't you see what's going to be happening? Okay. And remember, now I wonder, what was the Abrahamic covenant?
Well,
your sons will be as many as the stars in the sky.
Stars of the sky and the sands on the seashore. What else? Good.
Blessing of the nations.
Through you, all the nations will be blessed or will bless themselves, right? Okay. Notice, Abraham and his wife are being recalled here. What about the covenant with Noah? I will never destroy you again. What was the sign? A weapon of war becomes a sign of peace. Okay? Mary, verse 8. Keep reading.
Once when he was serving as priest in his divisions, turned before God, according to the practice of the priestly service.
Okay, this is what I was referring to, what Hezekiah did. You see, he organized them. Go ahead.
He was chosen by lot to enter the sanctuary of the Lord to burn incense. Then,
okay, this is a special event, burning incense, and when he came out, he would give the people a blessing. By the way, I have to. We went to a an archdiocesan meeting, and this was Saturday. And it was a presentation on the new marriage rite. There's a new marriage rite for all Catholics. And many of us deacons have not been having service at the wedding. In fact, I guess most of us have not had service at weddings because there's no Eucharist, or at least no consecration of the Eucharist, okay? So, we had 3 or 4 presenters, and one of the presenters said, for heaven's sake, don't have your book in your hand like this and raise your hand. It looked like you're about to pat him on the head. No. He said, have a servant, and adults can be servants. Somebody's holding the book for you right here, and you stand with your hands like this. So the deacons are getting straightened out. It's about time. But my mention of his coming out to bless the people, okay, you'll see what happens. Go ahead, Mary.
Then when the whole assembly of the people was praying outside at the hour of the incense offering, the angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right of the altar of incense.
Okay, now. Let's see, you're going to find out who this angel is, but I'm going to tell you now this angel is Gabriel. You know where you find Gabriel appearing before?
Announcing the birth of Jesus.
Birth of Jesus? So he's going to appear again to Mary. Where else?
To Abraham.
An angel appeared to Abraham. Again, notice you keep that content. That just keeps being referred to. Also, Daniel. You said earlier, Dan, I think you said blameless and righteous. Okay, Daniel as well. And the angel was named Gabriel that appeared to Daniel. Most of the time, the angels are just angels. Okay, angel means what?
Messenger.
Good. Okay, go ahead, Mary.
Zechariah was troubled by what he saw, and fear came upon him.
Now notice, fear came upon him. By the way, any of the rest of you have a different statement about what Zechariah's response was?
What verse is she on?
Verse 12.
Okay. Anybody have anything different here?
Mary, what did yours say again?
Zechariah was troubled by what he saw, and fear came upon him.
See, mine is when Zechariah saw him, he was terrified, and fear overwhelmed him.
Okay. Thank you. That's the reason I wanted to read that, because that's very different from the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Fear of the Lord is not terror. Can you follow me? And it's not overwhelming fear. It's awesome fear. And so, a lot of people have said, what's the difference in Zechariah and Mary's response? Because, okay, here's one big difference. He's terrified. Okay, keep reading here.
But the angel said to him, do not be afraid, Zechariah.
Okay, by the way, have you noticed how often in all of this, in the New Testament, where traditionally it's fear not? Mm-hmm. Have you noticed that? Okay. Yeah, you're not supposed to be terrified. Awesome fear? Sure. But terrified? Overwhelmed by fear? No. Okay, Mary.
Do not be afraid, Zechariah, because your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall name him John.
Okay. Do you know what the word John means? Beloved of God. I'm very happy that my parents named me John. I hope it's true. It's beloved. Okay. And notice, Zechariah has been praying for a son. You notice? Keep reading.
And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He will drink neither wine nor strong drink.
Okay, now, this is referring to a tradition in the Bible that we skipped over because it didn't seem directly connected with the covenants. But notice, how many things are being brought in that are not directly covenants, but implicitly? Abraham, of course. All right? Would you go with me to Exodus? I'm sorry, not Exodus, Numbers. I think it's Numbers 6, but I should have checked. Yeah, Numbers 6. Okay, while we're doing that, do you remember any others who were barren? You mentioned Sarah. Okay, Abraham and Sarah. Who else? Do you remember?
Hannah, mother of Samuel.
Who else? Good.
Elizabeth.
I'm sorry?
Elizabeth, the one.
Elizabeth here, yes. Who else? I think maybe we need to look in, let me see, Judges, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges. It's before 1 Samuel.
What does that mean? What chapter?
Oh, 13. Chapter 13. Chapter 13 of Judges. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges. I always think it's appropriate to remind you that when I was a kid, I refused to memorize those because I said, who needs those? So then I had to learn them when I got older.
It would have been much easier when you were.
It would have been much easier. That's why I'm there. You're absolutely right. Okay, Jim, you got it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, verse chapter 13, verse 2.
Verse 2. There was a certain man from Zorah, of the clan of the Danites.
Okay, Dan was one of the descendants of Israel, Jacob, Israel. Go ahead.
Whose name was Manoah. His wife was barren and had borne no children. An angel of the Lord appeared to the woman and said to her, "Though you are barren and have had no children, yet you will conceive and bear a son. Now then, be careful to take no wine or strong drink, and to eat nothing unclean. As for the son you will conceive and bear, no razor shall touch his head. For this boy is to be consecrated to the God from the womb. It is he who will begin the deliverance of Israel from the power of the Philistine."
Okay, all right. Notice the overtones here. An angel came. Now, do you know what tradition, what Jewish tradition, Hebrew tradition, not Jewish tradition, Hebrew tradition, this is no wine, a strong drink.
Nazarite.
Okay, that's in number 6.
Isn't that the same thing that Paul does just before he is?
Yes, very well said. Paul, at one point, he has been a temporary Nazarite. And so he shaves his head then to begin a new mission. Yes, you got it. Okay. Okay. Lois, you got it, haven't you? Number 6. Start reading, please.
From verse 1.
Yes.
The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to the Israelites and say to them, when either men or women make a special vow, the vow of a Nazarite, go to separate themselves to the Lord. They shall separate themselves from wine and strong drink. They shall drink no wine, vinegar, or other vinegar, and shall not drink any grape juice or eat grapes, fresh or dried. All their days as Nazarites, they shall eat nothing that is produced by the grapevine, not even the seeds or the skins. All the days of their Nazarite vow, no razor shall come upon the head, until the time is completed for which they separate themselves to the Lord. They shall be holy. They shall let the locks of the head grow long."
Okay, now remember, this describes Samson, doesn't it? I don't know about the holy part, but much of the rest, yes. Okay, so John, like Samson, is to be a lifelong Nazarite. And the Pharisees are going to comment on that in relation to Jesus. Remember, the Pharisees said, Jesus said to the Pharisees, "John came neither eating nor drinking, and you call him a..."
Go ahead.
No.
One possessed.
You call him demon possessed. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and you called him
a glutton.
A glutton. Do you see the kind of thing that's going to be referred to later? And now you see where this comes from. Okay. Mary, continue.
"He will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb, and he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God."
Notice, he will be great, and he will turn many people to God. And this is, even Samson did that. There's a long tradition of this. Keep reading.
"He will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah."
Ah! We've already looked at this one, haven't we? Notice how important the Elijah is. Do you remember what Jesus said about
John the Baptist. When his apostles said, you know, why do the prophets say Elijah must come first?
Said Elijah did come first.
Yeah, Elijah did come. And he said, if you will, Elijah has already come. And they did to him what they did to the prophets. What was that?
Killed him.
Killed him. Killed him. And this is what Jesus is predicting his own, telling them his own passion, talking about his own passion. So notice, Jesus said, John the Baptist was Elijah. Did John the Baptist say he was Elijah? He said, no, I'm the voice of one crying in the wilderness. Interesting. Notice, John never put himself forward. In fact, what did he say? One is coming after me. That's exactly right. Okay? So, you see the kind of thing. I think I told you that to this day, at Passover, traditional Jews who are following tradition, set an empty place for Elijah. Jesus said, Elijah has already come. Okay? Keep reading, Mary.
He will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of fathers toward children, and the disobedient to the understanding of the righteous.
Do you remember how Elijah was described at the end of Malachi? Let's look at that quickly. The last book of the Old Testament, just before the gospel accounts. Last book of the Old Testament, Malachi chapter, it's either chapter 3 or chapter 4, it's the last chapter. Some of the translations have it as 4, some of them have it as 3. It could be 3:19, chapter 3 verse 19, or chapter 4 verse 1. Lois, you have it?
Mm-hmm.
Read it, please.
Mine's chapter 4.
Okay.
See, the day is coming.
Okay, that will be chapter 3, verse 19 in others. You got it? Okay, go ahead, Lois.
See, the day is coming, burning like an oven, when all the arrogant and all evildoers will be stubble. The day that comes shall burn them up, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch. For you who revere my name in the sun of righteousness shall rise with healing in its wings. You shall go out leaping like calves from the stall, and you shall tread down the wicked, for they will be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day when I act, says the Lord of hosts. Remember the teaching of my servant Moses, the statutes and ordinances that I commanded him at Horeb for all Israel.
That's another word for Sinai in Deuteronomy. It's Horeb in Exodus. It's Sinai. Are these two different mountains, or is it the same name? Two different names. We don't know for sure. Go ahead.
Lo, I will send you the prophet Elijah before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes. He will turn the hearts of parents to their children and the hearts of children to their parents, so that I will not come and strike the land with a curse.
Okay, now let's go back to Luke.
I can let go of all those other books.
You can let go of all the other books. Yes, sir.
Well, I got so many fingers.
Okay, Mary, start again with verse 17.
He will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of fathers toward children and the disobedient to the understanding of the righteous. To prepare a people fit for the Lord.
Okay, notice. According to this, the day of the Lord is about to occur. Okay. You didn't mean to keep this one. You didn't have it this morning. Isaiah 40. I like to go to Psalms, which is about the middle of the Bible, and then go to the New Testament, and you're gonna find Isaiah. It's Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, and Daniel. But Isaiah chapter 4. Yes. Remember, this is the beginning of what's called Second Isaiah. Isaiah 40. Okay, got it, Jim?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, start reading verse 3.
A voice cries out in the desert, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the wasteland a highway for our God.
Where did you hear this?
Yeah, a voice cries out.
This was in Mark. This was John. What John the Baptist was to say. Right? Keep reading.
Every valley shall be filled in. Every mountain and hill shall be made low. The rugged land shall be made a plain.
Okay, now notice. He's promising a new exodus. And remember, that's picked up in Mark. Okay, go ahead.
The rough country, a broad valley. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all mankind shall see it together.
What is a glory? Notice, glory is an abstraction to us. But to them, it was something. What's a glory?
An aura, a smoke, a halo.
Yes.
A manifestation of God.
And those are usually as
a pillar of
fire,
cloud.
By the way, do you associate a cloud with Jesus?
Yes, when he went up to the
ascension.
Yeah.
And he will return the same way on the clouds of heaven. So a glory is either a cloud, and as Jim said, that includes smoke and fog, and or fire. What occurred at Pentecost?
Tongues of fire.
Right? Okay, so notice. Come back now to verse 17, one more time.
Yes. He will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of fathers toward children and the disobedient to the understanding of the righteous, to prepare a people fit for the Lord.
To prepare a people for the Lord. Okay, keep reading.
Then Zechariah said to the angel, how shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years. And the angel said to him in reply, I am Gabriel, who stands before God. I was sent to speak to you and to announce to you this good news.
Okay, remember, that's similar to what the angel said to
Mary,
to Manoah. That the, shall I say, the Annunciation of Samson? Go ahead.
But now you will be speechless and unable to talk until the day these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled at their proper time. Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and were amazed that he stayed so long in the sanctuary. But when he came out, He was unable to speak to them, and they realized that he had seen a vision in the sanctuary. He was gesturing to them, but remained mute.
Okay, notice. They had been praying, and I'm reminded of what used to happen when I went to a religious college as an undergraduate, and we were expected to say grace silently, right? And so somebody would be like this and take a little too long, and everybody was supposed to pray, of course, and somebody would say, amen. Okay, the people were saying amen here, amen. It took so long. Okay, but when he comes out, he can't give them the blessing. He has no words. Okay, keep reading, Mary.
Then when his days of ministry were completed, he went home. After this time, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and she went into seclusion for 5 months, saying, so has the Lord done for me at a time when he has seen fit to take away my disgrace before others.
Okay, notice, in Old Testament tradition, remember there was no belief in life after death. How did you know that God blessed you?
Through your children.
Did you have many children? How else?
Possessions.
Possessions. You have a lot of possessions. One more.
Wife.
Wife?
Long
life. Children, many children, many possessions, long life. That was an indication of God's blessings. And so notice, if a woman had no children, God was not pleased with her, was the understanding.
How often do you get that too?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right, you had it in. Who's the first one, remember? Who's the first one mentioned? Who was barren?
Sarah.
Who else? Rachel. Rebecca. Rebecca, Isaac's wife. Rachel, Jacob's wife. Hannah, you mentioned earlier, Rosie. Okay, notice. Okay, all these that thought of themselves as God was displeased with them, how do we remember them?
Blessed.
They're some of the greatest ones. So, and remember, they're not talking about, by the way, I think we talked about this. Do you know what, when Ishmael was born, whose child was that?
The son of Abraham's slave.
He was biologically the son of Abraham's slave. But what did Sarah say about Ishmael? Go into my maid that she may have a child for me. Notice, so Ishmael was Sarah's child also. So again, you see all the kinds of things that twists and turns, different way of thinking. Well, I guess it's not either because we have surrogate now, so okay. I won't say that's going back to the Old Testament. Okay, go ahead, Mary.
In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a town of Galilee called Nazareth.
Okay. Do you know what, we already talked about Gabriel. The name stands before God. Go ahead.
To a virgin betrothed to a man named Joseph of the house of David.
Okay, do you remember Joseph? Do you remember a Joseph?
Yeah.
Who?
Son's throne is
Yeah.
King, Savior.
Favorite son of Jacob, Israel, who was sold, first thrown into a cistern,
then sold into Egypt, became finally second to Pharaoh, rescued the people and so on. Okay? Do you remember anything about Joseph besides these events, what was said about his character?
He's an organizer.
Pardon?
He's an organizer.
True. One rabbi, and I forgot his name, I'm sorry, said, of all the great ones in the Old Testament, Joseph is the only one of whom nothing bad is presented, unless you regard his early days when he told about what was happening in his dreams.
And, told about what was happening what?
In his dreams.
Oh, his dreams.
He dreamed that they were out in these gathering sheaves,
yeah.
And all the sheaves bowed down
yes.
their heads, you know, that kind of thing. They said, that was not very smart to tell, but... But would you call that lack of righteousness? Man, I'm not sure you would. But Joseph is the only one. People have said the original dysfunctional families were Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and David and so on. But notice Joseph. There is absolutely nothing negative said about Joseph. Okay? Any question or comment before we go? Let's go on. Mary? Verse 28.
20, okay. And coming to her, he said, Hail, favored one, the Lord is with you.
Okay. Hail, full of grace. Why do you have favored one? What is grace?
Blessings.
A gift from God.
Gift from God. We deacons now have been told to read a book by Father Homeboy.
Rohrhausen?
No. Richard
Rohr.
No. I'm sorry, he's a Jesuit at Creighton University. Hauser, and it's on the Spirit. And one of the things he says in that book is that for so long, we Catholics have seen ourselves as terrible people, deep down, basically terrible. And he said, that's not Catholic doctrine. By the way, that is what's called it's called Catholic Presbyterianism. You're totally depraved. That's not Catholic tradition. He said, Catholic tradition has seen deep down the most basic part of us as good. Why would that be so?
Because the Lord's living in
us. God's living in us.
You're a temple.
Because God's living in us. He's in us. And how were we made?
His image.
Image and likeness of God. Did our turning away and going our own way destroy that image?
No.
Wounded it. Damaged it. We could say all kinds of things, but not, it did not destroy it. And he said, so we tend to think of grace as a thing, a special gift or something like that. He said, grace is within us. That's God's favor, God's goodwill. And what we have to do is be open to the Spirit, open to the Spirit, so that God's grace, which is within us, as you said, which is within us, has an opportunity to grow, has an opportunity for us to become mature Christians, mature people. if we think of ourselves as terrible, then he says we think, I've got to do this good deed and that good deed and that good deed to show that I'm worthy. He said, we're never worthy. It's not a matter of being worthy. It's a matter of to be open to the mercy of God. Remember, this is the year of mercy. So I guess this is one reason that we've been asked to read this book, because he's certainly dealing with that. That God's grace is his forgiveness, his mercy, his goodwill, his favor toward us. So that's the reason you have favored here. That's a translation. When it used to be extraordinary, full of grace. Completely favored, yes, that's grace. Okay, go ahead, Luke.
And coming to her, he said, Hail, favored one, the Lord is with you. But she was greatly troubled at what was said and pondered what sort of greeting this might be.
Notice, she's not terrified. She's not overwhelmed by fear. But, okay, go ahead.
Then the angel said to her, Do not be afraid, Mary.
You're not afraid? Don't be afraid. Okay, go ahead.
Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus.
Okay, what is the Hebrew for Jesus?
Yahweh.
Pardon?
Joshua.
Joshua.
Yeah. Literally, if you want to reconstruct it, it goes like this, Yahshua. But that's the way we've come to write Joshua. Okay, who brought the people out of slavery? Who brought them into the promised land?
Joshua.
Okay, I think we're going to get somebody bringing us into the promised land here. Okay, keep reading, Mary.
He will be great and will be called Son of the Most High.
Okay, now what was said about John?
He will go in the spirit and power of Elijah.
Yes. And he will be great in the sight of the Lord. Mm-hmm. All right. Come back to where you were, Mary. Verse 32, is that where you are? Mm-hmm. Okay.
He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of David, his father.
Here we go. Okay, now notice. We've got another covenant here. What was the Abraham, the promise was what?
Plentiful children will be his
family.
Many children, many descendants, and
all
nations be blessed. Okay, Abrahamic covenant. Notice that was the way Matthew started also. Look, Luke is starting in effect the same way, but giving so many more details. Okay, what's the Davidic covenant?
Justice.
Pardon?
I thought it was justice.
There will be justice, but that's not the complete covenant. What else?
There will be a son on my throne forever.
David's son will be
king.
Will save Israel. Will bring Israel. Will restore Israel's glory.
David's son will be God's son. How long will he rule?
Forever.
Forever. Did that happen in history?
Yes.
No. David's son is not still ruling when Jesus comes. Do you follow me? David's son, who was the last Davidic king? At what event?
Babylon.
Babylon. Remember the Babylonian king had his sons killed before him, and then did what? Put out his eyes. That was the last
Davidic king. Okay, now, what is Luke telling you? He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. That's what David's son would be called. And what else? How long will this be? Start at 32 again, Mary.
He will be great and will be called Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of David, his father. And he will rule over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end.
Okay, this is almost directly taken from 2 Samuel chapter 7. And I'm not going to take you back to that, but okay. Here is fulfillment of promise. Abraham, we have the covenant, now the Davidic covenant, and we have thrown him in the middle of the Noah covenant. Okay, go ahead and hear.
But Mary said to the angel, how can this be, since I have no relations with a man?
Okay, notice, it isn't that she's saying, oh, that can't be. She says, how can it be? By the way, you know what Mary, what, oh boy, I blew that one. You know what Mary is in Hebrew? Oh, you didn't hear it, good. Do you know what the name Mary is in Hebrew?
Miriam.
Miriam. Who is Miriam in the Old Testament?
Moses' sister.
Moses' sister. Yeah, she was the one, remember, who got the
basket.
Yeah, and Pharaoh's daughter said, find a wet nurse for my child. And so she took him to his own mother. Okay. Okay, go ahead, Mary. Verse 35.
And the angel said to her in reply, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God.
Okay, Son of God. All of this, from verse 32 through where Mary has read, is almost straight out of 1 Samuel about David's son. By the way, remember what David's son, literal, biological son, who succeeded him was named?
Solomon.
And what does the word Solomon mean?
Peace.
Shalom is a variation of the word shalom, peace. So, and what kind of reign is David to bring? Lois?
Justice.
Peace and justice and peace. Interesting. Put justice first. Justice and peace. Okay, Mary, go ahead.
And behold, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age. And this is the sixth month for her who is called barren. For nothing will be impossible for God. Mary said, behold, I am the handmaid of the Lord. May it be done to me according to your word. Then the angel departed from her.
Okay, notice. Of course, all of us recognize this. She's the first to say yes to Jesus. Okay, questions, comments?
I think just an interesting thing in notation in my book. Going back to the beginning of Luke makes it clear that the real beginning of the story of Jesus lies not with Jesus' birth, but in the ancient past, in God's ancient plan to bless the nations.
I think that's a good, I like that note. It's very consistent with what we've been talking about all this time, isn't it?
Yeah, I've always questioned why Zechariah was left mute, and Mary seemed to question the same thing. In the interpretation here, what I wrote down was Zechariah said, how shall I know? Mm-hmm. Mary said, how can this be?
Exactly.
Totally different.
Yeah, and Zechariah was terrified. Mm-hmm. Mary was perplexed, puzzled. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it's subtleties like this that really will forget. We'll stop here and I'll pick up a part here and I'm planning to go into the. If we finish with this next time, oh, we will not meet next time. Thank you. October 4th, Ruth is having knee replacement surgery, so I need to be with her, and so we will not be finished. But one thing I was going to say, I was sitting behind a woman and her daughter, and the scripture was being read about the king that came, and you have to check to make sure you can go out. And the woman was saying to her young daughter, "What a horrible God this is." I thought, oh my word. That's the way she's hearing that. I wonder how many parents thoughtlessly say things to their children that will be hard to forget.
Yeah.
You know? And that's the kind of thing they don't forget, and we totally, it was a passing thought. We don't remember it. So, yeah, Lois is calling attention to how subtle this is, very important. Shall we pray? In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have given us minds to think as well as hearts to feel. You've given us so much, most of all, the grace of your presence within us. Help us to be open like Mary, that we may receive the fullness of your blessing as she did. Guide, direct, and keep us sensitive, open, aware of how we present our faith, and forgive us for the way we sometimes do present our faith. Guide and keep us through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
Don't do long.
You got it right this time, right?
Yes, you sure did.